let me ask you a question today. What does it take to wake you up in the mornings? Now, some of y'all listen, I know you say, hey, bro, this is easy breezy for me. Every morning at 4:07, my eyes pop wide open. It don't take nothing to wake me up. I am up and at 'em. All it takes is maybe a little peek of sunshine through the blinds, or just a smell of the coffee in the morning. I'm just a natural morning person. I just wake up easy and free. Lord bless y'all souls. Then there's some more of us need a little extra help, right? So we have a little beam, beam, beam alarm on the side. Maybe we have to have somebody in our life that helps to motivate us to get up. They come in, they use one of the big threes, so you remember when you're a kid, you don't want to get out of the bed on a school morning. And so step number one, mom or dad comes inside, and they do the most horrible thing they can do. They turn on the light switch. Oh, it hurts our eyes so bad. They're trying to motivate us to get up. If the light switch doesn't work, they move to step two, and that's rip the covers off your body so you're freezing to death, Oh, you're alive and you pull the covers. If those two things don't work, then you go to step three, and that's the cold water veins. Most special cold water, that'll wake you up in the morning. So some people wake up really easily, and some people have to have a little more help and intervention. And then there's some people that even all those things don't seem to work, especially maybe when we enter into this daylight savings time. Today you thought, oh man, I feel like I lost 4 hours of sleep last night, not just 1 hour. So I found two inventions this week that maybe just for you, if you have a hard time waking up, maybe you can bring this into your homes. Number one is called the Slack Alarm Clock. And so it has this rotary thing in there, and the alarm goes off, and there's a video, and it just goes in circles and just slaps you in the face over and over and over. Yeah, see, in my mind, I think, well, I can overcome that. I'll just scoot down a little bit. It can slap my pillow all it wants to, and I'll keep on sleeping. So if this is ineffective, here is a last resort for you. This is called the catapult bed. You set an alarm, that thing will throw you out the bed. It will slam you against the wall. That's one way to wake up in the morning. Hello, good morning to you. Ah! So without question, everybody in this room wakes up a little differently every day. Some of you wake up so easy, some it's a little harder, some of you need the catapult bed. But that's how we physically wake up. Today what we want to look at is, what does it take to wake us up spiritually in this life? If you have your Bibles, turn to Jonah chapter 1. We're going to finish out chapter 1, verse 17 today, and sneak into chapter 2 for just a little bit. Let's see what it takes to wake up Jonah today. Jonah 1:17 through 2, verse 10. So here's a quick review. God has called Jonah and says, Jonah, you arise and you get yourself over to Nineveh. And Jonah arises and he goes the wrong direction. So he goes down to Joppa and he gets on a ship and he is headed out to the sea, and God hurls a great wind. And all the men become afraid. They begin to pray and they ask all these false gods and idols, what's going on? Who have we made upset? And how can we calm this storm? And they pull Jonah out and they cast lots and it's his fault. And they go, what do we do? How do we fix this? And Jonah says, throw me into the sea. And so they pick him up and they cry out to God and they say, please don't hold us accountable for doing this, but we think it's what you want us to do. So they throw Jonah into the sea, and it says immediately the sea was quieted and it became calm. What we want to see is we want to see Jonah having this spiritually awakening moment. We want him to be able to say, listen, I see the error of my way. I've been running from God. I've got to stop doing this. Lord, I was wrong, and you were right. That's what we want to see when we left off last week. Instead, what we saw was Jonah saying, you know what? I don't know that I'm sorry. I just would rather die than to do the will of God. That's what I know right now. So just throw me into the sea. So what will it take to wake Jonah up and open his eyes? Number one, we're going to see the alarming arrival. Verse 17. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and 3 nights. So the sailors, they listen to Jonah. They hear his suggestion. Throw me over into the sea. They cry out to Jonah's God. They pray and they vow. They throw him into the oceans. They see God's great power. And it seems to change their lives right then and right there. And then it says, the Lord appoints a great fish to swallow up Jonah. Now, we expect that, or most of us do, because we've read this story, we've heard this story from childhood. But I can see a lot of other outcomes that would have made sense to me in this situation. I can see it saying, so the men threw Jonah overboard. And at that moment, Jonah sank down to the bottom of the sea, and he was never to be seen or heard from again. That makes sense to me. That's what you get, Jonah. You shouldn't have been running from the Lord in the first place. I can read that. I would be okay. I can read it saying, they threw Jonah overboard, and all of a sudden Jonah found a piece of driftwood, and he clung to the driftwood, and he floated for days, and landed on an abandoned island where he named a coconut Wilson and lived out the rest of his time alone. That can happen. I can see him saying, he threw Jonah overboard and the seas were quiet and God was appeased and he saw what happened and he saw Jonah's sacrifice, so he told the men, throw something down there and get him back on the boat and take that fool to Nineveh. That could be a possibility too. What I don't see is that he was swallowed up by a fish. This is not a normal occasion. We're not going back and saying, well, back in the Old Testament, people were swallowed by fish all the time. No, they weren't. This is a special occasion. These things don't happen every single day. And so it says the Lord appoints a great fish, an aquatic beast. And so one of the most important things I think we can understand about this passage and this word right here about appointing is this was not the situation. The situation was not, well, the men picked up Jonah, they threw him into the water, and the Lord goes, they actually did it. I never thought that would happen. I can't believe they threw him in the water. Well, I don't want him to die. I got to do something. So I'm just going to create this beast right here and right now. Poof, like magic, and this beast was there. Now, could God do that? Absolutely. But that's not what God did here. By appointing, it means that this sea creature was in the sea already. It was swimming around. So instead, what we see is a picture of God's great sovereignty. That when he created this aquatic beast 20, 30, 40, 50, 100, 200 years before this, that he knew that at this exact moment and this exact time and this exact place that he would use that great fish in the story of Jonah.
Right.
See, he's shown us that he controls the winds, he controls the waves, and he even controls the fish. Right. What a beautiful picture that God is always in control of absolutely everything. So he swallows the fish, and he's swallowed by the fish and goes into the belly of this whale for 3 days. And for 3 nights. And as a child, and even as an adult, when we read narratives and stories like this, I love to have a picture in my mind. And then, you know, I wonder what it looked like inside the belly of that whale. And from childhood, even maybe up till today, I always have an image that looks something like this. There's old Jonah sitting in the fish, you know, and they're just kind of resting on top of the water. He has him a little snack, a little fire. It's warm and it's dry in there. He has a little mini fridge and microwave on the side. He has a futon over in the back. There's a little walking trail and a rock garden. In my mind, I think it's this big, spacious, almost room like this. And he has all this time and this space. Folks, it was not like that in there. I do not believe that. I see this image in my brain, but I do not believe it was like that. I believe that he was inside the belly of a fish. If you've ever looked inside a fish, it ain't good. It smells bad in there. It's slimy. It's intestinal. It's gross. And it's scaly. So there sits Jonah, or maybe there lays Jonah. Can you think about the smells, the texture, the darkness, the fear, the staleness of the air? And it says he was there for 3 days. It points us towards Matthew 12:40. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. So we can say, well, look, he was in there 3 days, 3 nights, so that later God could use this great Old Testament story, and he could say, in just the same way that Jonah was in the grave and rose again, so will our Savior Jesus Christ go to the grave. And he will raise again. But I think another point of why it was 3 days is because I think that's about how long it took for Jonah to finally wake up. Have you seen somebody in their life? I know that you have. And they are absolutely walking down the wrong path. And they are taking the wrong trail. And they are making the wrong decisions. And you keep asking yourself over and over again, I wonder when they're going to wake up. And you see them make one bad decision after the other, until finally something happens. And their eyes are opened and they see the truth. See, I think that's what's happened to Jonah. As a servant of the Lord, he was a mouthpiece for God. The moment that he decided to run away from Nineveh, you know he felt conviction. You know that inside he is going, oh, this is not a good plan, but I am not going there, so I'm going to keep going this way. And when he gets down there and sees that ship, you know in his mind and his heart he's going, oh, I want to get on that ship to get away from this place. But I still know it's wrong, and yet he did it anyway. He goes down to the bottom of that ship, and you know he is overwhelmed, thinking, I am running and I am hiding from God. What am I thinking? I'm just going to go to sleep and try to forget about everything that I'm doing as though it's not even happening. And the captain comes down and says, Jonah, we're all praying. Why wouldn't you be praying too? And he's going, oh, I should be praying, but I'm not because I don't want to. And they point their finger at him and say, Jonah, this is all your fault. And surely he's going, yes, this is all my fault. But still, he's not waking up. They pick him up and they throw him into the ocean. That ought to be the moment. I've been cast overboard. I'm not going to make it, yet even still being thrown into the ocean. And then in God's grace and His mercy, He has him swallowed up in this fish so that He gives him even more time so that he can see the truth and that his eyes can be opened. And so I think what happened in those 3 days, I think Jonah had a little bit of time to think about what he'd been going through. And he had some time to think about the actions that he'd been taking. And I think this is what we would call a come-to-Jesus moment. I'm not sure what it takes to get your attention in this life, but I'm pretty sure if you were swallowed up by an aquatic beast, that might get your attention. If running away from God, the conviction and the finger pointing and being thrown overboard, almost drowning, didn't work, maybe being swallowed up by a fish, that will get your attention. So I think it's right there that the alarms started going off. The hand was slapping him in the face. He had an IV drip of 3 gallons of hot black Folgers bold coffee. And his eyes were starting to open up. And the truth is that we love to give Jonah a hard time. Can you believe that, fellas? A servant of the Lord, mouthpiece of God, running from him, hiding from him, disobeying him. What was he thinking? I would never do something like that. And yet, how many times does God call us and we run away? And how many times does God clarify the mission and instead we just try to change it or alter it? How many times does God pursue us and yet we just try to hide as though he can't see us? After 3 days, I think that he's beginning to wake up. You know, I wonder where we have to be in this life to where God has to wake us up. I wonder if we ever run and hide and try to change his plans enough where finally God throws us overboard and swallows us in a fish so that he can get our attention and wake us up. 3 days, stinky intestines, loneliness, reflection, darkness, and solitude. And then finally, we see number two, the assuring acceptance. Verse 1. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God, from the belly of the fish. You know, why is it so many times in this life that our prayer life becomes so much more substantial and so much stronger and more solid and a regular part of our lives, something that we are absolutely dependent on when we're down in the bottom of the valley. And yet when we're up on the mountaintop, our prayer life is non-essential and non-existent. He prays and cries out to God, glory be, that's wonderful, but it's from way down there in the valley of the world. Verse 2. And he says, I call out to the Lord, out of my distress. And he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. He's starting to wake up here. He's got one eye cracked, and he's wiping up the sleep out of the other eye. I called out to the Lord, not in praise, not in worship. I didn't call out saying to him, my God is alive. Instead, I called out to him in distress. And even though I'd been disobedient, even though I'd been running from him, even though I hadn't been speaking to him and I was giving God the silent treatment, when I called out to him, you are never going to believe what happened. He heard me. He heard me. And he listened. I can see Jonah having this moment of revelation saying, you know, I used to go before the people. And I used to preach God's word to them, and I used to tell them the absolute truth. And when everything was going right in those people's life, they would spit in my face and tell me they have no need for the God from whom I serve. But then as soon as tragedy strikes in their life, guess which God they were crying out to? And I would yell at them, and I would say, shame on you for only calling on God when you need something. And now here I am doing the same thing. Crying out to Him, only in my distress. From the belly of Sheol, the realm of the dead, the bottom of the sea, I cried out in fear, and when no one else could hear me, he did. Verse 25. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the floods surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight. Yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. It was you that cast me out. The men picked me up. They threw me over. But this was all part of your plan. And through the heart of the seas, your waves, they were beneath me. They were above me. They were around me. And they were over me. I was surrounded. And I thought I was being driven from your sight. God, I thought you were pushing me away. But instead, what I see now is that you weren't pushing me. I was running. You were trying to bring me back home. And so I look upon your holy temple and I fix my eyes not on the creation but the Creator. Verse 5. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. At the roots of the mountain, the very bottom of the sea, I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. Yet you brought up my life from the pit. Oh, Lord, my God. The waters, they closed in over me. There was absolutely no hope for survival. I was drowning. The weeds wrapped around my head, the very bottom of the mountain. The seas, the lanes, the gates of death. My life was over, and yet you saved me. Oh, Lord, my God. Psalms 18 echoes these words, verse 1. The cords of death, they encompassed me. The torrents of destruction assailed me. The cords of Sheol entangled me. The snares of death confronted me. In my distress, I called upon the Lord. To my God I cried for help. From his temple he heard my voice, and my cry to him reached his ears. Two things about these verses. Number one, the cause of suffering. From one perspective, Jonah's having a really bad week. First, he has to take this really, really long journey far, far away from Nineveh because God wanted him to do something just absolutely ridiculous. So now God has put this burden upon him. He has to travel all the way down. After traveling all that way, he had to pay this very expensive fare to get on the ship. He gets on the ship and he's treated as an outsider. They get onto the seas and the waves are crashing and rocking. They enter into this horrible storm. He is seasick. Then all these men on their ship who should be his friends, they should be like cruise directors because he paid the fee. Instead, they point the finger at him, they blame him, they throw him overboard, he almost drowns, and then he gets swallowed by a giant aquatic beast. Poor Jonah, having to walk through all these horrible things. And yet from
my perspective on the other side of the table, I would say, we know Jonah. Maybe, just maybe, had you done what the Lord asked you to do in the first place, you could have avoided all those things altogether. See, sometimes we like to say, listen, I'm walking through this in my life because I am suffering for Jesus Christ. And let me tell you the truth. The Bible tells us over and over and over again that if we walk by faith and not by sight, we are going to suffer in this world because the world hated Jesus first, it will hate us too. We are going to walk through hardships. We are going to go through trials. We are going to have temptations. We are going to have very hard days in this life. That is absolute truth from Scripture. But when we make foolish decisions, and when we live in selfishness and disobedience, we do not have the right to claim that we are suffering for Jesus Christ.
Right.
Life can be very hard, and it's even harder when we make selfish and disobedient decisions. So yeah, Jonah's had a really bad week. Well, what do you think was going to happen, Jonah? The Bible's full of promises, given what the whole Old Testament theme is for the Israelites. Obedience equals blessing. And disobedience equals curses. It's not good. Obedience, much better way. Disobedience, not the way you want to go. So yes, he's had a bad time. But how much of that was brought on himself as he ran away from the Lord? But the second thing that we see is the power of grace.
Yeah.
He starts to put them pieces together. So let me get this straight. I ran from the Lord. I hid from the Lord. I disobeyed the Lord and I walked away from the Lord. And when I needed him, I cried out. And he was still there for me. When I had fallen, he picked me up. And when I saw that I was wrong, when my eyes were finally opened up, he didn't say, "I told you so, you fool." Instead, he opened his arms and welcomed me home. The power of grace. Remember the definitions. I've always heard this in my life. Justice, mercy, and grace. Justice is when you receive what you deserve. Mercy is when you don't receive what you deserve. But grace is when you receive what you do not deserve. He says, what I deserve was death in the bottom of that cold ocean. But instead, God showed me grace, and he saved my life. Let us be reminded that no matter how far we fall, no matter how much we run or try to hide, when we turn back to God, his arms are open wide. Number three. And then we see the Almighty's answer. Verse 7. When my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord. And my prayer came to you, into your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols, they forsake their hope of steadfast love. In the very worst moment of my life, he says, there in the bottom of the ocean when I am drowning and dying and I'm crying out to God, he heard me. He listened to me. He picked me up and he saved me. And yet not 5 minutes ago, I was standing on the board of a boat with a group of men who not 10 minutes before that were crying out to all these false gods and their distress. And there was no one there to hear them. How selfish of me to know the truth and the way to the one true God and not tell them whom their help could come from. What an image of us in the world so that we are surrounded by people who are looking for hope in hopeless situations. They're trying to find peace in places that cannot be provided. And they are searching for water in dry weather. How often do we, like Jonah, just hide in the bottom of the ship and simply keep our mouths quiet while the world perishes? Verse 9. But I, with a voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Oh, his voice is changing here. His eyes are open. He is actually set up out of the bed. Earlier I cried to God in my distress, but now I cry to him
in thanksgiving, and I will sacrifice to you. I will complete my vows that I have given to you, Lord. And maybe he's talking about the vows that he gave him before when he was a mouthpiece and a servant of the Lord. Or maybe in the moment of his death, when he's about to be drowned, he calls out and says, God, if you will save me, I vow from this point forward, I will always be obedient. And here's the reason why. Because salvation belongs to the Lord. His eyes are open. He's finally awake and seen the truth. And then verse 10. And the Lord spoke to the fish and vomited Jonah out upon the dry land. Three things about these last verses. Number one, the Lord is faithful to his promises. There has never been nor ever will be a promise that God has broken to us. And we should be faithful to our promises to him. Number two, the whale was obedient to God. A giant aquatic beast who was created much lower than you and I, who were formed in our mother's wombs in the likeness and the image of God, could obey him immediately. How ridiculous that we ever even consider disobedience to God an option. Because if the whale could obey him, surely we have the foresight and the thought process to know that is our best option as well. Number three, it wasn't true. Do you know what's wonderful about the word vomit? Nothing. Do you love the way it rolls off the tongue? Vomit. Vomit is vomiter. Vomiting vomit. It's a horrible word. And so going back to my childhood, this is what I want to see. I want to see Jonah sitting there with his fire, right? He's roasting some lobsters. He's having a good time. And all of a sudden he sees the truth. And the whale's, you know, blowhole opens up. And all of a sudden, Jonah's raised up on this well of water. And he's raised up into the air, and this magical wave carries him over to the shore. And he walks off looking like Charlton Heston, the Ten Commandments. I have seen and heard from the Lord. He's radiating, he's glowing. I want to see this beautiful image of what it looked like. And so God reminds us that's not what happened when he uses the word vomit. This was ugly. It was dirty. It was gross. He was covered in it. Who knows what? He's probably eaten up by all kinds of well stomach acid. He smelled bad. Baker says he was white, wrinkly, and stinky when he came out of that pinch. It was not pretty. This was not a beautiful moment where he said, yes, I've seen the truth and I've heard from the Lord. Now I'm utterly restored 100%. That will prove him up. Terrible. Here's the truth of this life. Being a follower of Jesus is not always pretty. Life's circumstances are not always pretty. It's not always fried chicken buffets and sunshiny days. It's not always blue bonnet fields, money in the bank, and health to spare. It is not always happy, happy, happy with the side of life is good. Life circumstances can be hard and ugly and stinky and dark and cold. And there are days that we're going to make mistakes. And we're going to fall short. We're going to disobey. And our seas are going to roar. And the wells of this life might just swallow us up. And there will be other times that we walk right before the Lord. And we do absolutely everything that God has called us to do, and yet somehow, still the waves are crashing. And still we feel like we're getting swallowed up by wells, and we're going to ask the question, what am I supposed to do? Number one, look for the alarming arrival. Because if God is trying to get your attention, I promise, you will know. So listen for the still small voice. Believe in assuring acceptance. Because even when you fall short, his grace is sufficient. Right. Regardless of what you have done, God loves you. And he's for you.
So please follow the Almighty's answer to the question, what am I supposed to do? And here's what Jonah says. You find salvation, which only comes from the Lord. You make sure that everybody else knows that He is the only true hope. And you obey His every call to the very end. Lord, today, we pray that we would be a people who are awake in this life, who are not spiritually sleeping, or just going through the motions. God, I pray that we can learn from this story, this narrative, or this account in the life of Jonah, that even when we run, and even when we hide, and even when we try to change your plans, Lord, you still pursue us with your love. And then finally, in a moment of clarity, we see the truth that it is not our will to run from you. And it is not our place to question you. And it will not bring us joy or peace or love to disobey you. So Lord, I pray today for those who are in this room who need to be awoken, who have been spiritually sleeping and going through the motions hour after hour, day after day, but they feel like finally the waves are beginning to crash and the aquatic beasts are swallowing them, or they are drowning at the bottom of the sea. But I pray that they would have a moment of clarity to where they could see that even in their lostness, even in the darkness, even in our distress, you turn your ear towards us. God, remind us today that in our darkest hours, you are not pushing us away, but you are drawing us nearer. God, I pray today that we would cry out to you and be reminded that your promises are true, that you never leave us nor forsake us, that you stand behind us and you go before us. So Lord, whatever our situation may be, I promise to follow you. Lord, I vow to obey you, and I will keep my eyes upon you and not the winds and not the waves, but my Creator, my Sustainer, and my Savior. Lord, we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.